Hello and welcome inside the Edward Jones chatting cage. Matt Yaloff here with you. A show for you, the fan. You get to chime in. You get to do the video call or on Twitter. Or get involved in the show. Today, Ned Colletti joins us inside the Edward Jones chatting cage. And he is joining us right now from the field where he belongs, on a baseball field. Hello to you, and thank you for doing this right off the bat. Happy birthday, belated by one day. The gift is on the way, I promise.
Thank you very much. Pleasure to be on today.
All right, well, I got to ask you this. I mean, you have worked in baseball for more than half your life. Management, upper management. I have your book right here, if they can show it. I want to hold it up. The Big Chair. You do charity work, and now you're involved with TV work. Can you pinpoint a moment or a day in your career that stands out above anything else?
I can pinpoint a time in my life when none of that was possible. I was a high school senior, and I had bad grades. I had no money for college. And my college counselor says, go across the street and get a job in a factory because that's about the best you're going to be able to do.
Wow.
From that moment on, I've been on a bit of a mission. And I've had the most blessed life and a great opportunities over and over again by people who gave me an opportunity and a chance.
That's amazing. So you have been out to prove people wrong. Is that part of it?
Yeah, I think, you know what, I come from a humble background in the suburbs of Chicago. I grew up in a garage till I was five. My dad remodeled a garage into a house. My mom made it into a home. First of my family to go to college. So I've been up against it from time to time, but I also figured out, hey, nobody cares about it. You got to have to make your own way, and you're going to have to be as good as you can be. And you can't make any excuse because people don't want to hear about it. They just want to see what you can do and give you an opportunity after you've earned it. Not before you've earned it, but after you've earned it.
Wow, the American dream. You are a perfect example of that. So congratulations on your hard work and perseverance and all that. Let me get to the guys, some of them, who you drafted while GM. I'm going to name a few, not all of them. Corey Seager, Alex Verdugo, Clayton Kershaw, Cody Bellinger. And I'm doing that for a reason. For me, Cody Bellinger has become a stop and watch guy. Whatever you're doing, you got to stop and watch him hit. Tell me about the evolution of Cody Bellinger.
Well, very interesting. He was a high school draft as a first baseman, but we loved the athleticism of him and thought you're rarely going to draft a high school first baseman high, but we did that because of the athleticism, but also as a senior in high school, I think he hit one home run. And so you really had to have a lot of projection. We had great scouts, guys that could really project. I think where he's at right now, I think you're absolutely right. I think he's must-see. Because you know what else he does? He just doesn't hit home runs. He runs hard. He's up in the league leaders and beating out infield hits. He knows how to run the bases. This kid can win a gold glove at first base and center field and right field in time. He's got a great arm. The kid can play. And I think this year you're seeing really the bookends of the first year with 39 home runs and people kind of adjusting to him. Last year, a little bit of a slide back, but still 25 home runs. And you, a lot of learning, a lot of education went on for him. I think he really adjusted to it. And now I think you're seeing the culmination of a lot of hard work and some struggle last year. He has been one of the best in the game.
So he hit one home run in high school. I hit none. So me and him are really not that different, are we? No, I'm kidding around.
You would have been right behind him in the draft.
Right. About 25 years later. Let me get to a tweet right now. It's about Clayton Kershaw. And the tweet is this. Is there anything that you can share with us about him that only you know?
Not sure about that, but I can tell you that early in his career, and you look back a couple of years ago, he had one of the – I think he had a record-breaking year of strikeouts versus walks, that ratio. And if you look back at his early career in the big leagues, it was about 2-1. He was up among the league leaders in walks. So I sat him down one day. I said, look at your batting average against. Nobody's really hitting you. But look at how many base runners you're forced to go through, and you're getting to 100 pitches with two outs in the fourth or early in the fifth or some point at that time. So you've got to really get your command straightened out. So he sent him back down for a little while. He was disappointed in that, but it really kind of fine-tuned his command. So possibly it was that conversation where I said, look, nobody can really hit you. Your ball moves. You can keep it in different parts of the strike zone, not just throw strikes, but throw effective strikes when you can throw a strike. But you're getting too big a pitch count. You're falling behind too many hitters. So you're going to have to fine-tune that. I think a couple of years ago, he might have had a 17-to-1 ratio. I think it was record-breaking. But you go back to his first couple of years, you're going to find about 180-some strikeouts and about 90-some walks. So too many walks, but he's really straightened that out well.
Yeah, he got the message, apparently, and he is going to the Hall of Fame one day at some point. We have a video call for you right now, so say hello, tell us your name and what you want to know.
Hi, my name is G. I'm a big baseball fan, and I want to know, what's your favorite part about general managing the Dodgers?
My favorite part was the competition. Every day you had a chance to win. Every day you had a chance to make a team better and even make people better. I think that's that was my favorite part. It's what I missed today a little bit is that competition, that daily competition. Every day you've got a game pretty much. You got about 3 weeks off over 6 months. 3 weeks are kind of spread out. But I think that the idea that you have a chance every day to compete at the highest level, this is where the greatest baseball players in the world play. And to have that opportunity, I think that's the thing that I really love most about it.
Do you miss it, though? Do you miss the daily grind of being a GM?
I do. And I think the TV work gives me a little bit of that to compete and to learn really a profession that I was interviewed, but I had never done television before. So there is a little bit of that competitive edge in there that you try to be as good as you can be with something that you're learning as you go. But I miss the team building. I miss not only the team building of the people in uniform, but I miss the team building of a front office. I miss the competition.
Yeah, and the TV work, how about that? I mean, I'm guessing now, and I don't know, I'm not going to talk for you. I'm going to guess you sleep better now than you did as a GM.
Well, I can tell you, when you're in a GM, you're just looking for a nap.
Right.
It could be in the middle of the night. You're hoping to get a nap in, you know, because your mind's always working, you know.
Sure.
And baseball gets played from February to October, sometimes a touch of November. But you're thinking about it simply every day of the year. There's not a day goes by. And I'm ashamed to say, even on Christmas, I would be sitting there thinking about the Dodgers, thinking about how we can make this team better, thinking about the first call I'll make in the morning. So you never do shut it down.
No, do you like the TV angle, though? Do you like being the guy who is asking rather than being asked?
You know what? I found, maybe because of the first thing I told you about how I grew up, I understand how life goes. And I understand also that, you know, you can have a beautiful view out of one window. But life is meant to have a lot more looks to it than just one window. So me having an opportunity and the Dodgers being great with me to give me this opportunity after my GM days to do television was really a huge blessing for me, too, because it keeps me close. It keeps me involved in the sport that I love and I'm passionate about, and it keeps me thinking about it. And, you know, to ask questions of people that I've signed as free agents or people that I've signed as high school or college athletes, that's a little strange. It was a little strange at the outset, but I think we're all over that. But it's been a tremendous ride for me and an opportunity that I'm very, very grateful for.
Yeah, and you have some resume, man. I'll tell you, I was reading about everything you've done, and I kept saying to myself, I forgot about that. I forgot about that. So good for you. Another tweet right now coming your way. Are the Dodgers involved in any talks with Kimbrel or Keuchel? Can you add to that at all? Are you allowed to add to that?
Well, I wouldn't know if they were or they weren't. I think that you're always going to look at every opportunity you have as a leader of an organization. I'm not sure if they're doing that with either of those players or anybody else at this point in time. I think it's got to be the right situation, too. And just my own opinion, pitching is tough to not start the season with. Spring training is there for a reason. Spring training is a long exercise. And really, in my opinion, it's there really for your pitchers to get enough work in, especially your starting pitching. And I know these guys have been probably throwing on the side, maybe throwing at their old high school or college and trying to stay loose. But it's not the same as pitching against big league hitters. You see players that have had spring training and they get hurt and they go on a rehab assignment and maybe they pitch a couple times in the minor leagues. When you're pitching against a big league hitter, it's a different game. And I think it's tough for a pitcher to come in when you get to late April, early May, and pitch and be effective. I think few guys have done it. Loesch didn't sign that far. He signed late in the spring a few years back, and he had a good year. But I think Kyle Loesch was a bit of an outlier. So I'm not sure what the market's going to be for those guys. But to me, it'd be a little bit tough to expect them to be who you thought they were, especially the rest of the season.
All right, we have another video call, so join in. Here we go with a video call. Your name and your question. What is it?
Hi, Ned. My name's Ryan. I'm a lifelong Dodger fan. Thanks for your contributions to the club. Rough start to the season for Joe Kelly. I've read some things that maybe the Dodgers are tweaking is his delivery, his motion. What are you seeing from Joe Kelly? When do you expect we might get to see the dominant Joe Kelly?
Well, I see somebody with a great arm. I don't think there's anything wrong with the arm. I also see somebody, and I don't know Joe that well. I know him from across the field when he was in St. Louis, and I talked to him a couple other times during spring training and Fan Fest, so I don't really know him that well. But I do see him trying to press a little bit. I think he's a kid from the neighborhood, so to speak. He lives near Dodger Stadium, grew up here. So I think coming back here, I think there was huge expectation on his own part to be as good as he could be, as quick as he could be, and to make a good impression. I think sometimes you can try to do too much. I've seen him overthrow. I've seen him miss with his fastball a little bit. Sometimes when you overthrow, to me, it could be that you're just trying to do too much too quick. I think in time, as he starts to smooth out and Dave Roberts gets him some opportunities where, and you can't always script this because the game doesn't allow it, it's just scripted. But sometimes there's a place to put somebody in a game, like last night, where you got a chance, a little bit less pressure, a little less leverage to it. You've got a chance to kind of relax and just be yourself and to gain on that and get some confidence. I know probably two dozen players in the Baseball Hall of Fame, and they all went through different bouts of losing confidence, wondering if they were going to be able to maintain the greatness that they had achieved for months on end or years on end. So I do think confidence plays a little bit of it, but I love his stuff. I love his competitiveness. He knocked us out of the LCS years ago when he was in St. Louis. 8 pitches in, he breaks Hanley Ramirez's rib. And, you know, he competes. We saw it last year on this field with the Red Sox. So the competitiveness is there. I think once he settled down and really gets a little bit calmer with his approach and can really maybe, I don't know, just blend in a little bit, I think that'll be a good thing for him.
And I want to mention, you said it in the NLCS, you went there as GM in 08, 09, and 13. Not an easy thing to do in today's game. I mean, that is quite the achievement. And now I also mentioned guys who you drafted. You did not draft Tom Lasorda. However, you know him very, very well. Give me your favorite story about Tom Lasorda.
Oh, goodness, I got a million of them.
Give me
one. It's a little bit of a longer story. I had dinner with Frank Sinatra years ago, and I know Frank and Tommy were great, great friends. And in the course of dinner, I'm working for the Chicago Cubs at the time, so I have no affiliation with the San Francisco Giants where I work later. But I'm sitting with Sinatra, and he says, you know, I love baseball. I'm close with Tommy, but I grew up a New York Giants fan because of where I lived in Hoboken, New Jersey. So I'm thinking, well, that's kind of interesting because Tommy's, you know, got Frank in a Dodger jacket, and he's always about Dodger, bleeding Dodger blue and all that. And so I see Tommy, like, years later, and I said, hey, I heard one time that Frank Sinatra was actually a Giants fan. And Tommy went crazy. And I mean, he would not let me up off the conversation. And I didn't want to tell him where I heard it. I just kept saying, I heard it from somebody who would know. And he wouldn't stop. And I was sitting with him, and I said, you know, this is the truth. And he says, tell me who did it. I said, I'll tell you, but it's going to break your heart. I said, it was Frank Sinatra himself. And he says, you got to go. So we were sitting together in the booth. He said, out. You got to go. I'm not listening to this anymore. But I love Tommy. Tommy's been great to me, great to my family. One of my favorite people of all time.
Yeah, and you mentioned him in your book as well. I read that passage not long ago. You had dinner with Frank Sinatra, and you brushed over that like it was nothing. I mean, good for you. All right,
it was a thrill.
I'm sure it was. All right, we have something now called the lightning round, and you would imagine that we go fast here. So I'm going to throw you a question, and you answer it, and then we roll on from there.
Is this a one-word answer, or is this a couple-word answer?
I'm going to give you leeway, given your standing and resume. Do what you want. Finish the sentence here. Clayton Kershaw is blank.
The best left-handed pitcher of his generation.
Finish this sentence. Yasiel Puig is
tremendously emotional and also exciting and also unpredictable. Completely unpredictable.
That one I actually agree with you on, and I knew that as well. Okay, ready? Magic Johnson is...
Magic Johnson, I've watched him play at Michigan State in college. I've watched him and admired him for a long time. He's a leader. He's somebody that knows how to win.
Andrew Friedman is...
Andrew Friedman is a longtime friend. I've known him since he came into baseball. He's brilliant. He's very, very smart. Thinks out of the box. He's got a wide, wide width-band of how he thinks and what he can accomplish.
Ned Colletti is...
I don't know what I am. I'm a guy that's always tried hard.
Well,
always gave him my best effort day in, day out, every day, every day.
That's a great quality. All right, now here we go. I'm going to continue on here. Who had the biggest influence on your career?
I would say Dallas Green and Brian Sabian. Dallas Green, early in my career, gave me opportunity, gave me a chance to continue to grow in the profession. And working with Brian Sabian for 11 years, I think it was almost a brotherhood. We were so close, and we argued, we debated, we kind of culled each other's thought process to make each other as good as we could. And the Giants started to go from a Candlestick Park team that couldn't draw any fans to a beautiful ballpark on the Bay. A lot of good teams there, including some world championship teams. So
excellent.
Those two people.
Excellent. Okay, one move as a GM that you did not make that you wish you had made?
Very easy. 2008, I think we had a chance to get CC Sabathia, Jamie Carroll, and Casey Blake from the Cleveland Indians in the middle of July of 08. We had a lot of injuries. We needed somebody who could really sit at the top of the staff, and we weren't able to complete it. We got right down to the 11th hour, I thought. A couple days later, was traded to the Brewers and had a great run to get them into the postseason. That was the one trade that I thought we were within an inch of getting done. Couldn't get it done.
Wow. Do you remember who you were going to give up?
We were going to give up five players. Four of them were prospects that had maybe a minute or two in the big leagues, but nothing of substance. Oh. The other one was Carlos Santana.
Oh, wow.
And we had to trade Santana. We had to trade Santana in order. We traded him about 2 weeks later to get Casey Blake.
Right.
And we were in a different situation then. Cleveland paid all of Casey Blake's salary. We had to give up Santana because we had him in the earlier deal. We were really struggling in the infield. It helped us win two divisions in a row and got the two LCSs with Casey. But having an opportunity to get CC and not being able to do it, I thought was a chance to really kind of put us at the top. If you remember that year,
yep.
We went to game five of the LCS against Philly.
Yep.
Having CC in that staff on top of that rotation may have made a difference.
Yeah, I would think it would have made an impact in some form, for sure. We're almost done. Do you want to see more analytics or less analytics in MLB?
I want to see balance. I want to see a balanced approach. I think there's value in both. I think you've got the two schools of thought. What I would also like to see, and I don't know where it exists or where it doesn't exist, but I would love to see respect for both sides. Mm. That the analytic group respects the scouting business, that the scouting business respects the analytics of it all. I think when you can cooperate and you can really be in the same page and really work together to understand the thought process, I think you have a chance to maximize every asset you have. I think they're both powerful. I think melding them and making them work together and getting them work together, those are the best teams out there.
Childhood hero, who was it?
My father, my mother.
It doesn't get any better than that. Final question for you. If not a career in baseball, what would you be doing?
I hate to think of what I'd be doing.
You can tell me.
I have no idea.
Come on, tell me.
I probably would have been a factory worker, and I probably would have been looking to retire and probably hoping that one day I got a salary and not an hourly wage. When I grew up, I hoped my kids went to college, and I hoped I could pay a mortgage and not rent, and I've had all of that happened. I've got great family, great kids, highly educated. So it's been a great thing. But you know what one of the coolest things is?
What's that?
We've won a couple Emmys. That I've won a couple Emmys, I can't believe that I won a couple Emmys. Not with this face.
Do you carry
the makeup people do a great job.
Do you carry them around with you? Do you have them in the car?
No, but I No, but I got them prominently displayed because nobody would have ever thought I'd work in baseball for almost 40 years or be the GM of the Dodgers. Nobody ever thought that. But to think that I've been awarded two Emmys with a group of people that work hard and are so good at what they do and kind of carry me through the show, that to me, I still can't believe that happened.
That's great. Ned Colletti, thank you so much.
You're welcome. My pleasure.
And good luck. And in anything you do, I know you will do it well. Ned Colletti joining us here inside the Edward Jones Chatting Cage. I'm Matt Yaloff. Thanks a lot for watching and taking part in the show. We'll see you next time.